This is our lecture number two, and today we will talk about state variable description of dynamic systems. I'm not saying control systems, just dynamic systems. I mean the systems that would normally be described using differential equations, systems that have inertia. At this point, you are familiar with the major components, major issues in matrix manipulation and matrix analysis, and you understand the concept of state vector of the system. And I want you to realize that the state vector of the system has the number of components that is equal to the order of the system, or the order of the differential equation that would be describing the system. Now, I want you to take a look at this expression. In this expression, x prime is the derivative of the state vector of the system. It comprises derivative of the first state variable, and it could be current, it could be voltage, it could be velocity, anything what you would include to be a component of the state vector. Now, keep in mind that the derivative of the state vector is a vector comprising derivatives of the individual state variables. This is matrix A. We call this matrix the fundamental matrix of the system. It is always a square matrix, as I told you earlier. The order of the matrix is n by n. This implies that the order of the system that we're describing here is an nth order system. Therefore, the fundamental matrix is a nth order matrix. This is the state vector as it is. Now, this is matrix B. This matrix B does not have any special name, but through matrix B, the outside forcing function, the external forcing function U, affects individual state equations. Now, this is the output equation. The first equation is called the state equation. This is the output equation. In the output equation, y1, y2, y3, and so on, they are all represented by the vector y. They are individual outputs of the system. What these outputs are? These outputs also are variables of interest. For example, if we have a multi-input, multi-output system, then every output of interest, every controlled variable, will be represented by the output variable in this equation. Matrix C does not have any special name. Matrix C describes how individual outputs are represented or are defined through individual state variables. And then there is matrix D, and matrix D defines how external forcing functions affect individual variables, but affect them without any dynamics involved. In this case, since this is a differential equation, first order differential vector differential equation, here we're dealing with dynamics, but I have to tell you that there are situations when the input forcing functions affect outputs directly without any dynamics in these channels. These are more notations that you have to take a look. This is the expression for state vector. It is a column. Look at this T. T stands for transpose. So if I would transpose this row, you would see a column, and this column is the state vector. And as you can see, there are a total of n state variables, which means that the system is a nth order system. The state vector is always a column, keep in mind. Now, if I am using the derivative of the state vector, it's also a column, and each element in this column is derivative of the appropriate state variable. And again, T is the symbol of transpose. Now, I have n number of components of the state vector. Obviously, the number of components of the derivatives of the state variables is also n. Now, the y that represents the vector of outputs, and again, it's also a column because this is a transpose sign, it has a different dimension. It is m, not n, but m. So it looks like we're dealing with a process that has description. For description, it has differential equations of the nth order, but the number of output variables is m. Could something like this happen? Yes, it could. This is the vector u, and this vector u represents all external forcing functions that drive this dynamic system. Now, the number of these forcing functions could be more than one. In this case, I wrote k. So I guess the process that we're looking at has order of n, because it has n state variables. It has number of output variables m, and it is driven by k forcing functions. I guess it's a quite complex system. As far as the matrices are concerned, the sizes, the dimensions of these matrices, supposed to be consistent with the order of the state vector, number of the external forcing functions, and number of the output variables. Again, the fundamental matrix is a n by n matrix. I want to reiterate, the fundamental matrix contains every single parameters of the system. Later, I will show you how to utilize fundamental matrix to determine system poles, to determine settling time, to investigate system stability. It is a very important matrix. Matrix B supposed to have dimension n by k. Because it connects k forcing functions, or k components of the forcing function, to n state variables or state equations. So obviously the dimension should be n times k. Now, matrix C, that also does not have any special name, this matrix connects the total of n state variables to m outputs. So obviously, it's supposed to have appropriate dimension, m by n. Matrix D is m by k, because for each state, for each output equation, for y1, for y2, y3, and so on, it connects individual components of the forcing function. Yep, this is a m by k matrix. Fortunately, in many cases, We will be dealing with situations when this matrix does not exist, which means that the forcing functions have no way of affecting directly output variables of the system, which helps. You know, I wrote that this is why x prime of t, x of t, u of t, and so on, which means that each state variable is a function of time, some kind of signal. Each forcing function is represented by some kind of signal. The output, each output is a signal. So this is good to keep in mind. You know, this expression is ideally suitable for describing a dynamic system that has total of m outputs, k inputs, and order of the system is n. This is a very complex system, generally speaking, and I don't think you would be having good time trying to use Laplace transform, Fourier transform for describing a system like this. And of course, our goal not only to describe the system, later we will be doing system design. So without state description, state variable description, without these matrices A, B, C, and D, it will be quite difficult to use this state variable model for system design. You know, fortunately, life is not that difficult. And in many cases, we can assume that m is equal to k and is equal to 1. What this means? This means that we're dealing in many realistic situations with a system that may be an nth order system, but it will be driven only by one forcing function, and the system will have only one output. So in this case, we're dealing with a single input, single output system, which is much more simple to handle. And in addition, matrix D, it could be zero. So our problem will not be that bad at all. Later, we will go into multi-input, multi-output system analysis and design. Right now, I guess we will be dealing with situations when we have single input and single output system, but the order of the system will be n. I also want you to realize something that initially may not be very straightforward to you. Let's say I have a particular dynamic system, physical system, and for this system we can get the system transfer function. And this is it. System transfer function provides unique description for the system. There is no way to describe the same system by two different transfer functions. Well, of course, I'm not talking about simplification. I'm talking about straightforward, honestly obtained transfer functions. For a particular system, a transfer function presents the unique description. This is not true for state variable description of the system. For any system, one can come up with many different, actually infinite number of different state variable descriptions, which means that in one case, you will have realistic physical variables, current, voltage, velocity, acceleration, elevation, temperature, whatever it is. And each of these variables will be represented by a particular state vector. And it could be the natural description of the system, the description that utilizes real physical variables, in the sense that one can mount a sensor and monitor this particular state variable. But then I have to tell you that you can come up with absolutely, absolutely fictitious state variables. Each fictitious state variable will be defined as a combination of real physical signals, of real physical, natural, physical state variables of the system. It could be done. And if you would come up with a particular set of artificial state variables, you will have very specific matrix A, matrix B, matrix C. If you would come up with a different set of state variables, again, artificial, matrix A, matrix B, and matrix C would be, again, completely different matrix. And you may ask me why this confusion is allowed in engineering. Engineering is supposed to be a very well-defined science, very well-defined approach to doing things. The answer is very straightforward. You may describe the system using natural state variables, voltages and currents and accelerations and deflections and things of this nature. And then you will have matrix A, and you will have matrix B, and you will have matrix C, possibly matrix D, and it would be a very straightforward description of the system. With one problem, this matrix A, matrix B, and matrix C may have such a configuration that it would be very difficult to solve analysis and design problems. So, should we give up using state variables? No, we shouldn't. We can switch from good, natural, straightforward state variables to the type of straight variables, to the type of state variables that allow us to have very convenient configuration of matrix A, very convenient, manageable configuration of matrix B, and very convenient, very manageable configuration of matrix C. And then we will take full advantage applying linear algebra to handle our problems. And we will solve our problems in the space of fictitious state variables. But then we're done. We have the solution. Now what we can do is to switch our solution from the domain of artificial fictitious state variables to the domain of real state variables. And then a quite complex problem will become very doable for you, and you will be successful in doing it. And you will be successful in using mathematical computer tools for doing it. So I guess one of the main tricks in the modern control is the ability to select a set of fictitious state variables that would enable you to solve the problem. And you can always go back, and when solution is available, switch it to the domain of real physical variables, where solution will be suitable for implementation. How to define the state variable description of the system? And if you remember my example presented at my during my lecture number one, I took a real physical system, I utilized equations of physics, the Newton's equations, the Newton's law, the electrical equations, and so on and so forth. I came up with this differential equations, linear differential equations. I had the first-order differential equations utilized, and if equation is more complex, I would split it. If equation has integral in it, I would still transform it to the first-order linear differential equation. And every physical variable that we utilized as the component of the state vector had very explicit physical meaning. Yep, this is how it could be done. However, there are many ways different from what I just discussed for obtaining state variable description. In many cases, in control environment and control business, you have transfer functions for this component and that component, and the manufacturer very often provides transfer functions. So technically, in control engineering problem, you would have system defined by individual transfer functions. Let's say you want to get the state variable description for the system. First of all these individual transfer functions could be represented by the block diagram of the system as particular blocks, and then you know how to convert block diagram into a high order transfer function, and then in order to apply modern control approach, you would be able to, or you would have to, represent your system by a state variable notation. And let me show you how one can take a transfer function to make our life easier. I use a fourth order transfer function, and how to convert this transfer function into a state variable description. And when you convert transfer function into a state variable form, the task is called decomposition of the transfer function. And now I will show you the approach which is known as the direct decomposition of the transfer function. I will show you how it works. But the beauty of it is you will do it a couple of times, but eventually you will learn how to perform direct decomposition by inspection. This is what you have to learn if you want to get a good grade in my class. So first of all, let's do it formally. This is the transfer function, fourth order. It is equal to Laplace transform of the output divided by the Laplace transform of the input. What can we do about this? First, we can, and I want you to pay attention that there is no zeros in this case. I have just a constant gain in the numerator of the transfer function. And I have the characteristic polynomial defined to me. What can you do first? First, what we can do this cross multiplication. And look, this is the cross multiplication. I multiply this characteristic polynomial by y. I multiply the input, Laplace transform of the input by the numerator, by k. And this is what I am getting. But then you have to recall that under zero initial conditions, multiplication by s in the power of 4 is consistent with the fourth derivative of variable y. And multiplication of y by s Laplace transform symbol in the power of 3 represents the third variable. And this is the second, the third derivative. And this is the second derivative. And this is the first derivative. And there is no derivative here. So look, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to realize that if I would convert this equation in S domain into the time domain, I will get this linear differential equation. And this linear differential equation will be fourth derivative of y plus a3 times third derivative of y plus a2 times second derivative of y and so on. And it's equal to k, constant gain, times u, u being the external forcing function. And then I can rearrange this equation by moving this a3 y third derivative of y and a2 second derivative of y into the right hand side of the equation. So obviously this is where this minuses will appear from. And then I would introduce a set of four state variables. Why four state variables? Not five, and not three, and not 10. Because our initial system was a fourth order system. So if transfer function is a fourth order transfer function, you have to expect to have total of four state variables. The definitions must be performed as follows. I would say that state variable x1 is equal to the output y. And I would say that the state variable x2 is equal to the derivative of the state variable number 1, which is actually y dot. And then I will say that x3, state variable x3, will be equal to the first derivative of state variable x2, which is second derivative of y, actually. And then state variable x4 will be equal to the first derivative of state variable x3, which is y3. So this is easy. And because of this, let me make the following statements, or let me write the following equations. First of all, you remember the format is, I have, this is the format. Well, I don't have it here, but our state variable format requires to have the column of derivatives of state variables, okay? So, and it could be later arranged into the derivative of the state vector. So, I have to write a linear equation for x1 dot. If you will take a look at this expression, this is the equation for x1 dot. It is equal to 0 times x1 plus 1 times x2 plus 0 times x3 plus 0 times x4 plus 0 times u. And please don't blame me for inserting the zeros, because we want to come up with a standard format for all linear equations, for all linear equations for state variables. I must have all state variables included in every equation. Now, if you will take a look at the state equation number 2, equation for x2 dot, obviously, it's written right here, x2 dot, what's equal to? It's equal to x3, nothing else, but I have to write it in the standard form. I have 0 times x1 plus 0 times x2 plus 1 times x3. This is what I wrote. Plus 0 times x4 and plus 0 times u, because u, the external forcing function, is not included in this equation. And then I will write the state equation for x3. And it's actually this equation. However, I am obligated to insert every single state variable in this equation. And I did insert them. 0 times x1, 0 times x2, 0 times x3, 1 times x4, and 0 times u. But then I have to continue doing this, making this, or building this linear differential equations. And now it is time to define equation for state variable x4 dot. What x4 dot is equal to? Obviously, these expressions do not have x4 dot, but if I will take the first derivative of x4, if I will get x4 dot, it will be equal to y4. Look, take the first derivative of this expression. This will be x4 dot. This will be x3 double dot. It's all right. But this will be equal also to y4. Where you see y4 here? This is the y4. So you see, equation for the state variable number 4 will have minus a3 times y3, y with third derivative of y. But third derivative of y is nothing but x. Let me see. Third derivative of y is nothing but x4. The next should be a2 times second derivative of y. But second derivative of y is x3. And then I will have minus a1 by times first derivative of y. Don't be confused. First derivative of y is x2. And finally, I will have a0 times y. And a0 times y is right here. It is x1 times a0, of course. And plus ku. So listen, it was so easy for me to write first equation and second equation and third equation, but when time came to write equation number 4, you have to use your brain a little bit, and I used mine, and this is what I got. The next one's I would suggest to do. Now, you also please realize that I want all equations to be written in the same format. Therefore, I have a0 times x1 first, and then I have a1 times x2, and then I have a2 times x3. So I guess if you would compare this equation against this equation, I had to change order of writing the individual state variables. But when I am done with this procedure, I am ready to convert this expression into the matrix vector form. But before I will do this, let me see how variable y looks like. This is how variable y looks like. It's equal to x1. So if my goal is to write equation for the output variable, I'm doing it by saying that y is equal to 1 times x1 plus 0 times x2 plus 0 times x3 plus 0 times x4 plus 0 times u. I have to insert all state variables in every single linear equation, and I did insert. But when I am done with this task, and when I am done with the definition of the output equation, let's recall that our goal is to get this matrix vector expression. And I can tell you that first of all, I have state vector x. It has four variables. I have matrix A defined in this way. Look how it is defined. Zero, the first row has 0, 1, 0, 0. Second row is 0, 0, 1, 0. Third row is 0, 0, 0, 1. And I can do it without any intellectual effort. And I have to wake up only when I'm defining the last row of this matrix. How about matrix B? You know that the output, that the external forcing function through gain k is included, is affecting only the state variable number 4. So in matrix B, I will have all three zeros and k in the last row. Matrix C is a row matrix. It has one, all zeros. And matrix D is a zero. Is a zero. Now, if I would have this matrix, this vector X, if I would have this matrix A, fundamental matrix, if I would have this matrix B, if I would have this matrix C, as soon as I will write form like this, you will implement every single state equation, and you would implement every output equation, which we have only one output equation here. Okay, so it will be x prime is equal to a times x plus b times u, y will be equal c times x. This part will not be, does not exist in my case. But then the point is, look, this is how matrix A looks like. This is how matrix B looks like, and this is how matrix C looks like. Can we write matrix A by inspection just by looking at the transfer function, this transfer function? Memorize this transfer function. And I will tell you how to build matrix A by inspection. Matrix A is supposed to be a 4x4 matrix because the order of the transfer function is 4. Matrix A is a square matrix. The first row of the matrix is supposed to have 0 first, and then 1, and then 0 and 0. The second row supposed to have 0, and then another 0, and then 1, and a 0. Row number 3 supposed to have 0, and 0, and 0, and finally 1. But the last row, as I said, you have to write cautiously. First of all, you have to have minuses in front of coefficients of this characteristic polynomial. You will have a3 with minus, a2 with minus, a1 with minus, and a0 with minus. But then, with these minuses, you have to place the coefficient of the zero order of s first, and then coefficient of the first order of s, and then coefficient of s squared, and then coefficient of s cubed. Should be 4 coefficients. And this is what you see here. This is coefficient of the zero order of s with minus, coefficient of s in the power of 1 with minus, coefficient of s in the power of 2 with minus, and coefficient of s in the power of 3 with minus. Matrix B is very simple. You have every element is 0 except the last one, which is equal to the constant gain. Matrix C is a piece of cake. You have to have 1, and all other coefficients are zeros. Matrix D, in our case, is 0. So each time when you will see a transfer function of this type, fourth order, fifth order, maybe even 55th order, you should be able clearly, easily, by inspection, define matrix A, matrix B, and matrix C. And, you know, it's called direct decomposition. But direct decomposition is a little bit more complex if the transfer function has zeros in it. And let me now consider this case. Before we will get this, I want to show you a numerical example. This is a fifth order transfer function. For some reason, I have to replace this transfer function by a state variable description or matrix vector description of the system, and I will have to use direct decomposition. Let's do it. First row is no problem. 0, 1, all 0. Second row is no problem. Third row is very easy. Fourth row is very straightforward. Take a look at the position of 1s in this matrix. They're not on the main diagonal. They are shifted to the right by one element, by one position. The last row is requires a little bit more responsibility. This element. Well, let me start from this element. The element with the lowest order of s and the power of 0 is 25. It comes first with minus. Element of the first order of s is 11. It comes here with minus. I have minus 12. I have minus 6. I have minus 2. I'm done with matrix A. It's a square matrix. Now, for matrix B, I even have no any intellectual efforts to be invested. All zeros and one. Matrix C has 13, this constant gain, and the rest of the elements are zeros. Matrix D is a zero matrix. Very easy to do. However, please keep in mind that direct decomposition results in a very particular set of state variables of the matrix vector form obtained by direct decomposition is a very specially defined set of variables. These variables are artificial variables, and they have right to exist only because later you will find out that this configuration of matrix A and matrix B and matrix C is exceptionally convenient for our analysis and design problems. As a matter of fact, this configuration of system description is known as the canonical controllable form. An abbreviation is CCF. And in the future, if I will ask my students, obtain CCF from this transfer function, you should be able to do it easily, quickly, efficiently, and without any mistakes. All right, but I did not cover the case yet when I have zeros in the system. Let's work on it. I have a transfer function where numerator is also a polynomial, so not only denominator, and this transfer function has obviously zeros, real or complex zeros. How to handle this situation? To handle this, and I still want to perform direct decomposition, of course. How to handle this situation? First of all, I would introduce an artificial variable v. And this variable v is such that transfer function v over u is 1 divided by this denominator. So at this point, I created an artificial system, and this artificial system has artificial output, and this artificial output related to the system input, to the forcing function, through this transfer function. Can you get the state variable description for the system? Assuming that V is the output. And I don't think you have to do any difficult. It will cause you any difficulties. You will get the a linear differential equation of the fourth order in this case. You will move these terms into the right-hand side of the equation. You know what to do. But I also want to look into the relationship between the true output variable y and the artificial variable v. The relationship between these two variables is very easy to visualize. It is this relationship. Because this is how we chose the state variable, this is how we chose this artificial variable v. According to the choice of the variable v, the relationship between v and y variables is defined by this transfer function. In other words, y, the output, is equal to C3 element of the polynomial numerator times third derivative of v plus C2 times the second derivative of v plus C1 times first derivative of v plus C0 times variable v. And it's very good to keep this in mind. Meanwhile, I will doing exactly the same gymnastics that I did earlier, and I am getting equation for x1 dot, which is 0 times x1 plus 1 times x2 plus 0 times x3, 0 times u. I'm getting equation for x2 dot, which is also very straightforward. I did it earlier. Equation for x3 dot is fine. And equation by x4 dot. But equation for x4 dot is not that straightforward. It's not that simple. I have to look at the fourth order differential equation for variable v. For fourth derivative of variable v. Because fourth derivative of variable v is nothing but the first derivative of variable x4. But, what do you see here? You have the state equations. And the state equations are obtained for the system where output variable is artificial variable v. But now I have to come up with an equation for the real output of the system. This is how y is connected to v. But v triple dot is nothing but x4. And v double dot is equal to x3. And v dot is equal to x2. And v in the order of 0 is x1. So I have the output equation for the system. Right here. And now, I want you to agree with me that we have the state equation for our system and the output equation. And therefore, I can introduce vector of state variables x, state vector, fourth order. I have to define matrix A exactly like we did it before. 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. But when you do the last row, this is the element of S in the power of 0 with minus. This is the element of S in the power of 1 with minus. This is the element of S in the power of 2 with minus. This is the element of the power s and the power of 3 with minus. Talking about these elements, about this characteristic polynomial. Matrix B has this very straightforward configuration, all zeros and 1 in the end. in the last row. However, for matrix C now, you will have element of S in the power of 0 in the numerator, but no sign change. S in the element or coefficient of S in the power of 1 in the numerator, S times, excuse me, this is the coefficient of S in the power of 2 in the numerator, and this is a coefficient of S in the power of 3 in the numerator. So you can do this by inspection, this type of analysis. And as a matter of fact, this is a very straightforward way of doing, performing direct decomposition. Doing it by inspection. This is how people who know what they do, do it. Well, how will you do it? You will take a look at the transfer function. You don't have to worry about artificial variable V anymore, because I used it only for my derivation. Looking at the numerator, first of all, you will realize it's a fourth order system. So matrix A will be a 4x4 matrix. You will have four state variables in the system. You will know how to fill the first element of first row of matrix A. You know how to fill the second row of matrix A, and so on. The last row of matrix A will have minus A0, minus A1, minus A2, and minus A3. For matrix B, you will have 0, and another 0, and another 0, and 1. For matrix C, you will have first element will be C0, then C1, C2, and C3. And you're done. Now, what about matrix D? Matrix D is 0 in this case. You don't need it in this case. You know how the situation will change if in the transfer function to be subjected to direct decomposition, order of the numerator is equal to the order of the denominator. How to handle it? How to handle it? You have to perform long division. And I am assuming that everyone in this class knows how to divide fourth order polynomial of the numerator by the fourth order polynomial of the denominator. You will perform this long division. And then you will perform this long division. You will get transfer function defined as sum of two elements. G0 is the result of long division. Reminder, I guess it's called. And G1 is the transfer function that has numerator order lower than order of the denominator. You will say now that y, the transfer function, is equal to the sum of two transfer functions. So, when it comes to the definition of matrix A, matrix B, and matrix C, you will be getting it by inspection for this transfer function. When it will be time to define the output, you will define output using this result of long division. A reminder of long division G. So look, you can do this by inspection, all right. So I have to tell you that variable G appears only in the situation when order of the numerator is equal to the order of the denominator. Well, I have to tell you that the state variable approach is not suitable for representing transfer functions of systems where order of the numerator is greater than the order of the denominator. But you know what? Fowler would tell you, Professor Fowler would tell you that this type of systems are non-causal systems. It's very unlikely that you would face a system like this in your future engineering practice. Let's perform, get, obtain the direct, the perform direct decomposition for this transfer function. And you can see that order of the numerator is equal to the order of the denominator. What would you do to do so? First of all, you would divide, perform long division. When you will perform long division, you will have two transfer functions. One will be real transfer function, another will consist only of one coefficient. This one coefficient will be matrix D, as a matter of fact. But you will get the direct decomposition by the first transfer function. And now I have to tell you, and I guess it's quite straightforward. You will face this type of problem in your homework. You would face a problem like this in your test number one, of course. So this type of stuff you must learn how to do. So what happens when you have a transfer function of the system and you have to obtain state variable description? You know, you're getting, performing direct decomposition, and you're getting a straight a state variable form that is known as the canonical controllable form. Canonical controllable form is the most useful form for your analysis and design problems. So please be prepared to obtain CCF. How do we obtain CCF? By inspection. I guess only this would be a great advantage for using CCF. But as I said later, you will have a lot of, you will see a lot of other advantages of working with canonical controllable form. And of course, again, you must know how to obtain it by performing direct decomposition. I also want to remind you that if you start state variable description from working with variables, with physical signals, with if you will start from working with equations of physics of the system, if you would be looking into the physical phenomena and come up with state variables, your state variables will be real physical signals, real physical variables. If you're getting state variable description from the transfer function performing direct decomposition, you will get a very convenient system to work with. But again, keep in mind that the state variables will be fictitious state variables in the sense that there will be no way of monitoring x1, x2, and x3, and you probably would never have the ability to talk about the physical nature of x1, x2, and x3. For example, x1 could be equal to some coefficient times acceleration plus another coefficient times displacement plus another coefficient times current plus another coefficient times deflection. You see, state variables like this have no physical meaning, but they enable us to solve very complex control problems. But when we're done with these problems, what we can do, we can convert solution into the domain of real physical variables and implement the system. As a matter of fact, if I have state variable X obtained somehow, it is always possible to convert state vector X into state vector Z by introduction of this square matrix filter. Matrix filter W times X will be equal to state vector Z. The order of the state vector Z will be exactly the same as X. However, However, z will be very, very different from x. Components of z will not have any physical meaning. They will be basically fictitious variables. And only what will happen because of this transformation. This transformation implies that for state vector z, you will have a very special fundamental matrix A, very special matrix B, very special matrix C, probably very special matrix D. And if you would choose filter properly, you will end up with a state variable description convenient for your analysis and design. I want to talk to you about matrix diagrams. If you will take a look at the matrix state variable description of the system, and I will take, let's say, this form, what do you see here? What you can see is this. You have the derivative of the state vector. It is equal to fundamental matrix times the state vector plus matrix B times the input vector. The output is equal to matrix C times the state vector plus matrix D times the external forcing functions, the input vector. Can we represent this in a graphical form? It is called matrix diagram. Look. First of all, I want you to take a look at x dot, derivative of the state vector. What it is equal to? It is equal to state vector times matrix A, or A times x. Look, here I have product, A times x, plus product B times U. So what will happen if I will add AX plus BU? I will get X prime. Listen, how I will get X out of X prime? I have to integrate it and I will have X. And please don't tell me that some kind of vicious circle takes place here. No, it is very reasonable and very logical to put this configuration together. X dot is equal to AX plus BU, which is fine. What will happen if I will have CX? X is here, C is here. And what will happen if I will add DU? I will have Y. So this is the state matrix diagram of the system, it is called, matrix diagram of the system. Matrix diagram has lots of deficiencies. However, nevertheless, it gives you some principle of how the system is built. For example, you can see here that the input signal affects the output directly without any dynamics, because this is a static channel, okay? It explains you the relationship between y and x, between u and x prime, and so on. But, you know, this matrix diagram is not that useful. What is much more useful is known the state diagram. And state diagram actually is a signal flow graph of a system. And state diagram could be directly converted into a simulation setup. And as a matter of fact, you and I have to get into the simulation of dynamic systems. And as a matter of fact, it's time to get involved into simulation of dynamic systems. Okay, how we simulate dynamic systems? I like vSim because it's ideal for making presentations to my students. If you will work in industry, probably your employer will prefer Simulink. Certain things could be done in MATLAB, but not to such extent. So listen, you have to get prepared to learning how to build state diagrams. First of all, I have in front of me and in front of you a system transfer function. And it's a single input, single output system transfer function. Probably initially, in the initial definition, I had order of the numerator was 5, order of denominator was 5, but then I performed long division, and this is what I have now. How to obtain the simulation diagram or state diagram for our system? Please take another look at the transfer function, and you have to perform the direct decomposition. And we will do it based on what I presented earlier by inspection. First of all, I want you to conclude that there are 5 state variables that have to be defined because order of system is 5. And I have here the state equation. And indeed, I have first derivative of x1, first derivative of x2, first derivative of x3, x4, and x5. Now, this is matrix A, the fundamental matrix of the system. Look, I define first row, and the second row, and the third row, and the fourth row, following this very simple rule. Now, we have to fill the last row, row number 5. This row number 5 should be filled based on the coefficients of the denominator. And we will start from minus 50 and then minus 22 and then minus 24 and so on. And here they are. Minus 50, minus 22, minus 24, minus 12 and minus 4. And this is multiplied by the state vector, not derivative of the state vector, but the state vector itself. And then I need matrix B, and matrix B is a column that has all zeros, and the last element is 1. And B is multiplied by the input signal or input forcing function U. So this is easy. The output equation supposed to have coefficients of the polynomial numerator of this system. And coefficients of the polynomial numerator will be listed without changing sign, starting from the lowest order of s. It will be minus 70, plus 22, minus 4, plus 8, and plus 8. And here I have them. Minus 70, plus 22, minus 4, 8, and 8, times state vector x. And then I need matrix D, and I have matrix D by doing the long division. Want to remind you that initially the order of the numerator was also 5. This is element that will be used for matrix D. A matrix D is multiplied by the external forcing function. So, how to simulate the system? Let's build the signal flow graph first for the system. I want you to imagine that I built x5 prime, the derivative of the state variable number 5 prime, or derivative of x5. Let's assume it is built here. How do we build x5? To build x5, please take a look at this equation. You know matrix multiplication. I have x minus 50 times x1 minus 22 times x2, minus 24 times x3, minus 12 times x4, minus 4 times x5, plus 1 times the forcing function u. This row has to be multiplied by this column, plus this row must be, well, it's a multiplication of the vector by scalar. And this is what I have. I have, presumably, this is x1, presumably this is x2, presumably this is x3, x4, and x5. I have x5 times, well, let me start from the beginning. I have x1 times minus 50, x2 times minus 22, x3 times minus 24, x4 times minus 12, x5 times minus 4, and I have u multiplied the forcing function by 1. They're all added together, and I have x5 prime. But then you will ask me the question, where is x5, where is x4, x3, x2, and x1? No problem. If this is the fifth derivative of x5, I would integrate it and I will get x5. But x5 is equal to the first derivative of x4, so if I would integrate x5, I will get x4. But x4 is equal to the first derivative of x3, so if I would integrate x4, I will get x3. If I will integrate x3, I will get x2. If I would integrate x2, I will get x1. So you see this part of the diagram of the signal flow graph gives me the state equation of our system, providing that I'm using the direct decomposition. But then you understand this is x5, this is x4, this is x2, x3, x2, and x1. Well, x1 times minus 70 plus x2 times 22 plus x3 times minus 4, plus x4 times 8, x5 times 8, and I have to take u, the forcing function, and multiply it by the element g. G is a matrix, but it's a 1x1 matrix, and I'm getting y, the output of this system. So it's no problem. It's all doable. Now, fortunately, software like VSim and Simulink enables us to build using interactive graphics this into the computer. And I will show you a little bit later that we have very convenient facility for building simulation diagrams. How would we handle, look, this configuration is quite simplistic. It is quite simplistic because it is canonical controllable form configuration. For canonical controllable form, we're getting basically the best of all worlds. A simple simulation diagram, convenient design, convenient analysis, and so on. There are still problems that canonical controllable form is not very good for. But anyway, we'll talk later about this. I want you to take a look at quite generic simulation diagram. This generic signal flow graph will be built for a state variable expression that is not canonical controllable form. How we handle the situation? If you would use your imagination, you will realize that x1 dot is equal to x1 times 2 minus x2 times 7 plus x2 times 4 plus 5 times the external forcing function. And this is exactly what I have here. It's x1 times 2 minus 7 times x2 plus 4 times x3 plus u times 5. I'm adding this up. But if I would integrate this sum, I'm getting state variable x1. And state variable x1 will be used right here. And I guess it will be also used for the definition of the output. Now, how about the second state equation? It will be x2 dot, it will be equal to minus 1 times x1, plus 6 times x2, plus 2 times x3, minus 3 times u. And I have it right here. I will add these things, and I am getting x2 dot. If I will integrate it, I will get a state variable x2, and it will be used right here and right here and within the rest of the diagram. And basically, this is how we're getting the state variable x3. When all the state variables are defined, I can take a look at matrix C, and I can take a look at matrix D, and I will define the output Y. Indeed, output Y is defined as x1 times 1 plus x2 times 2 plus x3 times 7 plus u, the input signal, times 0.7. Adding these elements will give me output y. How would you simulate system? Well, you have to apply some kind of signal, input signal, u. Whatever you will choose, sinusoid or step or whatever you, random noise, whatever you will apply, and then your system will live, will show its life. You will be able to see how x1 changes in time. You will see how x2 changes in time, how x3 changes in time, how output y changes in time. And if x1, x2, and x3 are real physical variables, you will get very explicit representation of your system operation. At this point, my lecture is over, and I will talk to you again in the video number 3.